Angelos Pangratis, who is the deputy head of delegation of the European Union to the United States. He is the former ambassador and head of delegation of the EU in Argentina, and also served in senior functions in at the EU embassies in South Africa and South Korea. In Brussels, Mr. Pangratis was the head of unit responsible for relations with China, Hong Kong, and other Southeast Asian countries. He also headed the unit of the personnel and budget at Directorate General, and also external relations and trade policy. He has lectured at universities in the Czech Republic, France, Belgium, United Kingdom, Korea, South Africa, and many other places. He comes from Greece, where he was born on the island of Corfu. I understand, a very beautiful island indeed. And he has obtained a doctorate from University of Paris Pantheon in international economics, monetary policies, and finance. And I'm delighted that he has accepted our invitation to come to Cato Institute today. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Tupi, for this introduction. Ladies and gentlemen, very pleased to be with you. Why do I have the feeling that I have a formidable task now? We had a good, interesting, and fascinating starting point with the invitation of the Cato Institute. I found it already a kind of challenging in itself. And I think, Dr. Tupi, you said it yourself, there is something of a provocation, even in the way it is presented, but the provocation, of course, of the good kind, what we need to make the debate interesting and build a fascinating, I hope, exchange. At least the themes are certainly fascinating. And, of course, Dr. Bolkestein, he's a great figure of European politics and of the Commission itself, and he gave us a very impressive list of issues, impossible to deal with all of them in 15 minutes, even in the 5 minutes of discussion. So just let me try to pick up a few key comments to make, because I think the real challenge in this big debate, when we talk about the EU, we talk about the complexity of the modern world. We talk about the effort to find the governance that makes sense in a world that is becoming more and more complicated every day, more and more interdependent every day, in a world where globalization moves ahead in an impressive speed, and with it a fundamental change in the interdependence among nations, individuals too, but nations particularly. And somehow I think countries around the world, the public policy, let's say, is struggling to find a way to respond to these changes that are taking place in terms of interdependence, in terms of the new globalized world that is emerging. And simply, I think globally, we don't have the answer. I think the starting point of any reflection of the kind that pretends to talk about the future and how relevant the EU is for the future has to be the following. If you take the more telling aspect of the international relations of our days, I would argue that this is the fact that public policy in general is tracing the challenges that it's facing. It's fighting to keep up with the challenges of modern world. Take the dominant issues of the day. What are they? Let's say the economic crisis, the financial challenge, regulating the financial entities that are more globalized than governments. We need much more than what we have in terms of public policy. Take the climate change. Are we really having a public policy response that allow us to claim that we are really doing enough to respond to that? Take trade. Are we really advancing the rules of international trade in a way that keep up with the challenges of modern world? Take the currencies. My point is that beyond the technicalities and the specificities, the real challenge is, are we building a governance, a system of governance that makes us able to respond to the challenges of the modern world? That's the bottom line. The technicalities are endless. The real the debate about possible issues are equally endless. So let me, with this in mind, make a couple of comments on some of the aspects that were raised in the invitation, because I think they were pertinent and in the introductory comments by Dr. Tupi. Concerning the EU, I think there are some fundamental misunderstandings, or very often, too often to my taste, we have criticism and arguments that are, in my opinion, superficial. We don't really see the substance of what is happening. One of those misunderstandings is this first statement in the couple of first lines of the 10 lines that were used to invite us here, that the Lisbon Treaty means a formidable increase of powers in Brussels and the area of foreign relations and the creation of the Foreign Service is more or less given as an example of that. Well, because we are talking a lot about the new institutions and particularly the High Representative, Vice President of the Commission, the new External Action Service of the EU, just please keep in mind in all this debate that, in fact, in this big area of the external competencies of the EU, the external powers attributed to the EU, Lisbon Treaty has not changed anything. It's just an arrangement of institutions, of processes, of putting together resources, of deciding in a certain way, but the basic competencies, the way the powers of Brussels are defined compared with the powers of the Member States, stay exactly the same in the external relations area, which is one of the more dynamic areas, we hope, of the Lisbon Treaty, and I believe we will see changes, but they are not part of this power grab process at all. Something else is happening. The same with this big debate about the fact that some national referenda were lost for the ratification, for the acceptance of the Lisbon Treaty, and somehow this is a democratic deficit. You know, there again, I find it a fantastic, you know, simplification. I mean, why the first Irish referendum with 1.4 million Irish participating and 53 saying no is democratically more valid than the second, where 1.8 million Irish participated and they gave a 67% yes? I mean, first, there is a big debate to have about representative democracy and the role of referenda, but certainly adapting what we are proposing, what we are presenting to our citizens, because they were not pleased with that, and coming back to that and asking them to think again, there's nothing undemocratic, quite the contrary. And I would argue, really, it's a big debate. We have just a few minutes, but think of it. I mean, what is democracy? What is the modern the challenge of modern democracy? Is not, you know, to have necessarily a majority rule at the level of the big entity of a big federal state. If you go below the federal structure and you ask the states to approve what you want, if each of the state has a veto, this is certainly a guarantee of, from a certain point of view, a guarantee of the rights of the minority in a certain respect, a guarantee of the rights of the states, and it's an element of deeper democracy. And the Lisbon Treaty, the way it was accepted, I would argue, represents 9 years of democratic processes, which can be seen as a process of profound democratic value. Concerning the bureaucracy, you know, that's a big debate. But there again, what does it mean, a bureaucracy? Of course, we have bureaucracies to manage the modern world. I don't think the issue is bureaucracy. By the way, you know, the whole EU, we are all something like 30,000 people, less than the staff of an average municipality. If we are really so powerful, then we are a very efficient bureaucracy. You cannot combine both. If we are really concentrating so much power, then at least you have to recognize that it's a very efficient democracy. By the way, the budget of the EU is 1% of the GDP, is limited to 1% of the GDP of the EU, right? Which is a tiny amount. And the legislation that is produced in our member states is to a very great extent based on what is happening in Brussels. There are estimates between 60 and 85% of the new legislation at the level of the member states originate in Brussels. So at least if we really have all this influence, we must be a very efficient bureaucracy. The issue is not the size of the bureaucracy itself, I would argue, with all due respect for those who argue differently, is how much democratic accountability this bureaucracy has. And that's the issue of the democratic, the debate on the democratic deficit of the EU. Now, the democratic deficit, again, an enormous debate, but I don't think anybody can argue that that the Lisbon Treaty is a step backwards at all. Clearly, the Lisbon Treaty represents a formidable, I would argue, step forward. First of all, the role of the European Parliament. Now, there is a debate about the representativity of the European Parliament, and I am very sensitive to the argument that we just heard from Mr. Bolkestein that the European Parliament needs to connect with the citizen much more. I think that's a formidable debate. I would agree with that. This is the new horizon of building a real political system in the EU, connecting really the European Parliament with the citizen. I think it's a big heading that we cannot expand too much now. It remains that I would argue that, of course, the European Parliament has a very high legitimacy, like any parliament elected directly in our representative democracies. And if there was an argument that I would have subscribed in terms of democratic deficit of the EU institutions is that we did not have really the European Parliament, that means an elected body, accepting all our legislation, which is the case now. As a result of the Lisbon Treaty, everything that is produced in terms of new legislation of the EU, it has indeed to be accepted by the European Parliament, that has the full legitimacy of an elected body. And we have the additional step forward in terms of accountability, even of the Commission, because the President and the Commissioners are accountable to the European Parliament. And in addition, we have a higher involvement of the national parliaments that can argue about, whether something can be better done at the level of the EU or at the level of the states. We have clearly a stronger voice for the citizens with 1 million signatures, and it's already working. We have a better definition of the competences between member states and the European Union, and we have the clear possibility for a member state to withdraw from the European Union. All that, all those elements are key elements increasing the quality of democracy at the level of the EU, and I think really it should not be underestimated. Now, looking forward, again, a huge debate, but just a couple of key ideas, really. What the EU means for the future, what's the relevance of the EU for the future? Again, there are many imperfections. There's a lot that can be done better. But I think we should not miss the sense of history, what has happened, what is the strength of this process, beyond its imperfections. And again, there are plenty. What the EU has really achieved? It was built to achieve peace. I think it was said and repeated. But how has it achieved peace and stability? I think basically there are two fundamental concepts there. First is the nation transformation. The transformation from within is the definition of values, the definition of the common legislation. Think in terms of enlargement, what it takes for a new member state to become a state, to become a member state of the EU. It has to adopt, of course, all the criteria, the Copenhagen criteria, political and economic conditionality, and the 100,000 pages of our legislation. So this is a process that transforms a state, and we have seen this. This is history. I'm not saying that. It's history. We have seen transformation of states step after step of enlargement. And when the state becomes member of the EU, the process is not finished, because that's how the EU works. I told you 1% of the GDP, the EU budget, but maybe 70 or 80% of the legislation produced. So we are building a system where member states learn to live together and grow in doing things in a compatible way. What I call transformation from within. And the other basic concept is the prevention or resolution of conflicts or difference among sovereigns. You can think of the EU as a system, as the unique system in the world of rule of law among sovereigns, among states. This means that it is in fact a formidable system of preventing frictions, because of the transformation that I just mentioned. More we have common ways of doing things, less differences that we have in a world where interdependence is exploding around us. It also means that there is the rule of law among sovereigns to deal with differences that they have. And it also means that because of the deeper integration and the deeper interests that we share, we can do wider compromises on a wider basis. That's why the EU is a constant negotiation, linking things that have nothing to do with each other. You give me that, I give you that, and then there are, on a wider view of interest, a better capability to find compromises and move forward. And please link that with my introductory remark. Here, what we are talking about is a new form of governance. And this is what we have to appreciate if we really want to answer the question, what's the relevance of what is happening for the future? It's a new form of governance that makes a state more able than anything else that we know to handle their interdependence, which is a challenge much wider than among the Europeans. So from that point of view, the basic strength of the EU, the basic mechanisms of the EU that have created this formidable success of peace and stability on the European continent are the same mechanisms that are particularly relevant for the future. And at least we need to try, we need to understand that, because we need to try to project these same concepts at a wider, on a wider basis. I don't say they are perfect. And there are plenty of valid arguments in what we have heard before and in arguments that can be made. But here is an example that is unique in modern governance and I think corresponds to the fundamental needs of managing this exploding interdependence among nations. To finish with the last concept that I want really to leave with you is that this governance is not based on rules, regulations, bureaucracy, and imposition of the state on the citizen. I think that's probably the most deepest misunderstanding of the EU. Think of what the EU meant for each one of us, for each one of the citizens of the EU. What does it mean to be a citizen of the EU? What does it mean? It simply means that you, as a citizen of the EU, or whoever, isn't it, has a number of additional rights. The right to study in another country, the right to live there if he or she so decides, the right to work, open a business, etc., or buy a holiday house on a Greek island. It's a right. So there are plenty of rights, and there are others. Also, the whole effort of the EU to create this common economic space, the internal market, the similar way of doing things, the ability to have recognition of your social rights coverage, you know, health coverage in another country, etc. It means that simply the EU has, without doubt, created a much more integrated space, thus more compatible to live, to adapt from the individual's point of view, a much open space to the world. I don't think there can be any serious doubt on that. And it has recognized a formidable set of additional rights to the individual. For the individual European, the EU has been a fantastic mechanism of increasing freedom, individual freedom. And I think it's important to keep this in mind for the rest of our discussion, because it comes at the heart of what the core values and the fundamental values of this integration process are. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Mr. Ambassador, Mr. Deputy Ambassador, and thank you for coming willingly into the lion's den of my invitation, and also Dr. Bolkenstein's remark.
Thank you, Dr. Tobin. I must say I enjoy deeply the quality of the arguments put forward by both speakers and now by Mr. Bolkestein particularly. I start with him and his comments. I would agree on something fundamental, I think. He states in a little bit direct way that the EU is moving in the wrong direction, and he explains this very eloquently. I think I would agree that what the EU does is not necessarily perfect, and a lot of things are happening that are not perfect. And I believe very deeply that we need the kind of debate that is launched here, because we need to think carefully about every step that the EU as such is taking, and invite everybody to realize how much the EU is a unique experiment. We are learning as we are advancing, and this is part of the concepts that we need to keep in mind when we consider the future and how much debating, studying, hesitating, arguing in all directions is a necessary part of the process. Defending the EU does not mean defending any aspect of possible initiatives that the EU is taking. This being said, the points that I want to take up briefly. I think this idea of this commission out there, that there is no restraint to the commission and on the initiatives that it is taking, it can be misleading for people who do not know the functioning of the EU enough, because the commission does not have any real decision-making powers. The commission takes initiatives, but the powers to decide, are with the member states and with the European Parliament. And the member states certainly have a say and have to decide on anything significant that the EU is pretending to act upon. So we should not, I don't think it's fair to have this concept of big distance between Brussels and the member states' capitals. It's part of the basic characteristics of the EU governance. Member states are everywhere in the process of the decision-making of the EU, even within the Commission itself, because we have special committees to prepare our proposals. So they are everywhere. So you cannot, I think, we should not leave to the audience the impression of this dichotomy that I think in very great extent does not exist, and on the contrary, it's one of the strong characteristics and unique features of the EU governance. Now, I repeat this debate on the European Parliament. I must say I share the fundamental feeling, I believe very much myself on a personal basis, that this is the new frontier of the advancement of the EU, is how the politics of the EU will really bring the elected representatives closer to the European citizen. I think is the next challenge of the European integration. I guess that's a kind of personal opinion. For the time being, the way of election, the way elections are arranged, in fact, people, voters, vote for national parties, which are represented to a second degree at EU level. And somehow, we have to bring the EU politics to the European citizen. But that's an enormous debate for politicians with big experience like Mr. Bolkestein, and that's as I said, in my opinion, the new frontier of building the EU further. Another important thing to keep in mind, when we talk about the EU increasing some of its budgetary means, again, very briefly, it can mean if we see the EU only increasing, you know, its requests, it can mean that they are out of touch with the overall reality of the EU. It can be. But that's a kind of debate that we have also with the creation of the EEAS, the new External Action Service of the EU. We might need some additional resources at the level of the EU to do what we are mandated to do as Commission or EU institutions. If by spending a little bit more at the EU level we become more efficient and we save more money from the national budgets, then the whole thing takes a different perspective. And I would argue and I would agree that we need to be preoccupied about this dimension or related to any thought or proposal of additional expense at the level of the EU. If not, we would run the risk, as Mr. Bolkestein said, to be out of touch with the reality. Last comment on the overall, really, argument, how relevant the EU will be for the future. Again, I understand what Mr. Bolkestein is saying, and it's a real question. He says, we have been very successful in building peace, dealing with the Soviet threat to some extent, building peace between France and Germany and on wider basis, but where are we going now? Are we really declining? Are we really losing popularity as EU? And is this now a process that will not be reversed? And that's what I tried. I think that's a key. That's a key point. That's a key concept. And that's what I tried to explain in my speech. I think there's something else that drives the EU now. There's something else that will make that the EU will in fact become stronger, not less relevant, despite the difficulties that we are having today and the difficult setup internally and international. And that's the fact that the EU governance, with the main characteristics that I tried to explain before, correspond to a fundamental needs of our times. We need this kind of governance to be able to have the Europeans together dealing with the challenges of our times. And I would argue that the world needs more of these principles on a wider basis. And I think this will drive the EU. And the real strength of the EU is that beyond the difficulties that we are seeing, in fact, we are seeing in parallel the European integration advancing very significantly. And I finish with a comment on Mr. Gillihan's comments that illustrate this last point. When we look at what happened with the monetary crisis and the euro, just to take the core element, I think, of the points that you made, what has really happened? It is true that the euro and the EU had to face a situation of crisis for which we were not prepared, for which really our system had not in advance established mechanisms and answers. And what we have seen is the top leadership of the EU getting together and taking decisions that really responded to the situation that we had. I would argue it's a long story, a lot to say. But fundamentally, we knew what were from the beginning, what were the weaknesses of the European Monetary Union. We knew that the common currency is only sustainable if we exercise fiscal responsibility, if we have convergence of competitiveness, and if we can cope with the crisis that we are going to come on us. And we had no mechanism for this crisis. And the mechanism for convergence of competitiveness proved to be not completely at the level that were needed, nor those of fiscal sustainability. So the whole governance of the EU had to, the monetary union had to adapt. And we have seen progress in the economic and monetary governance of the EU that were unthinkable 6 months before. We have seen decisions for hundreds of billions of mechanisms of support taking over weekend or days or becoming operational within weeks. And I finish with that. So what we have seen, I would argue, is the EU being able to manage a degree of flexibility that can be a great asset for the future, and walking out of the crisis much stronger than before the crisis arrived. So I would draw a little bit different conclusions from those that you drew, and I think it's an example that we need to think from that angle too: flexibility and ability to respond.
Okay, thank you very much, Professor.